What does multiplicity sound like?
Multiply.
Kinda.
Multiple.
It's more like multiples is, but I mean, those words come from the same place. But yeah, it kinda means like the multiple answers that you can get. So let's say you're solving a question by factoring. And you factor it, you get two of the same factor, right? And you set them both equal to zero. You get two of the same answer, right? We don't usually write x equals negative two, negative two. We don't write it twice, we just write it once. So a multiplicity is basically, there is a fundamental theorem of algebra. It's on your like theorem sheet. We'll learn about it later a little bit more in detail, but it says that the degree of the function is the same as the degree of the function is equal to the number of roots or the number of solutions that you should get. So we have to get two answers for a quadratic every time, even if they're two of the same. So what multiplicity does is it just kind of accounts for the fact that you might get two of the same answer instead of two unique answers. Okay? So example five, and these are going to be similar to the rest of the ones on 5-3. We have to find the zeros. So in order to find the zeros, you're going to make y zero. So step one, make y zero if it isn't already zero. If it's an equation, you want to get it set equal to zero in order to find zeros. Remember, zeros and roots and solutions, those are all the same thing. They're like asking for essentially the same thing, just in different contexts. So after you set it equal to zero for this one, we're actually going to be able to solve this by factoring. We're going to factor out the greatest common factor first. So what would be the greatest common factor here?
X squared.
Right, so take that out. So you're left with x squared minus 2x minus 8. And you're usually going to do something with what's left. So at this point, if you want, you can take the two factors and set them equal to zero. And this one we can do whatever we want to it. We can either try to factor it again, or we can complete the square, or we can use the quadratic formula. So I would factor if it factors. Is there a number that multiplies to negative 8 and adds to negative 2?
4 times 2.
So what kind of 4, what kind of 2 would add to negative 2?
Negative
4 and positive 2. Okay, so we factored. Now we use the zero product property again. We set those factors equal to 0. Okay, and we can solve. So here we're going to get 4. Here we're going to get negative 2. Going back to this part, technically, if it says x squared equals 0, in theory, that means that x times x equals 0, right? Isn't that what that means?
Mm-hmm.
So that means that, again, zero product property, I can take each one and set it equal to 0. And so I get two of the same answer. So you would say I get 0.
Can't you square root it and then you just get...
Yeah, I was going to kind of do that too in a second. No, it's cool. With a multiplicity of 2. Yeah, so another way I was going to say, another way of looking at that is usually to solve this, you would, so let me just kind of like rewrite it over here. First thing you would do is probably square root both sides, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then what do you do when you have to square root both sides? What do you do here?
Yeah, plus or minus.
Right, plus or minus, but you don't really have positive and negative 0, right? But the fact that you got two zeros from it, like you're still getting two zeros, like technically like a positive 0 and a negative 0, it's just that they're both 0. So you still get two solutions even if you do it that way. It's just that like you might not see it. Yeah.
So did you like split the zeros and you have like four solutions because of like that?
Yeah, so since it's
four,
a quartic,
yeah.
You should have like 1, 2, and then 3, 4
okay.
solutions, even though this one is like technically the same.
Okay.
So these two would have a multiplicity of 1. And this one has a multiplicity of 2 because we got two zeros, like 2 x equals 0.
Okay.
So that's what multiplicity means. Does that make sense? Not super important. I'm probably not going to put it on a test or a quiz. It's just going to be on Math Excel, and it's important in understanding the fundamental theorem of algebra, which says, like, the concept is important, which says that you should have four roots for a quartic. So that part is important. But I'm not going to make you write this, like, phrase with a multiplicity of two or anything like that on a test or a quiz. It's just important to understand the concept, because eventually we're going to solve, like, quartic equations, and to check your work, you need to make sure you get four. And if you get two of the same, that's okay, but you just still need to make sure that you're getting four. If you get three, then you're not done. Okay. So, section three is, where we have, like, equations instead of functions. We're kind of doing the same thing. So here it's got, what are the real and imaginary solutions? I'm just going to put that for pretty much, like, every kind of equation, because some of them are going to have complex or imaginary solutions, and some won't. But you need to make sure that you're finding both.
Like, I?
Yeah, I. So I, they might call them complex roots or something of that kind. Same idea. It's stuff with I in it, okay? So the first thing you want to do, if you're given an equation and you're trying to find roots, remember roots are the same as zeros, so it has to be equal to zero. Right now it's not equal to zero. So I'm going to subtract my 3x from both sides so that it's equal to zero. Oh, that's a 3. And then make sure you put it in descending order, because if you don't, then trying to factor it later is not going to make sense. And sometimes when I'm grading tests and quizzes, people try to factor something that's not in the right order and it doesn't work. So make sure it's in descending order, meaning the exponents are decreasing as you go down. Does that make sense? Okay, now after this, we're going to take out a greatest common factor. So what would that be?
X.
And we get 2x squared minus 5x minus 3. We have to take out that greatest common factor. If we don't take out the greatest common factor, then we're not going to be able to, like, factor after that, because right now I've only taught you how to factor quadratic equations, right? You've never factored anything with that, so we're trying to get it down to a quadratic. So then at this point, if you want, you can take your two factors and set them equal to zero. This one's done. Like, you have one solution. You're gonna get two more here. They could be real, they could be irrational, they could be imaginary, we don't know. So what I always try to do first is see if it factors. So since this one is has a leading coefficient, we would have to multiply 2 times negative 3 first. That gives me negative 6. Okay, and then making a list of things that multiply to negative 6. I'm looking for the 2 that add to negative 5. So are there 2 that add to negative 5?
1 and negative 6.
Yeah, 1 and negative 6. All right, so I'm going to factor by grouping. So I have 2x squared plus 1x minus 6x minus 3 equals 0. Okay, and then I'm kind of like splitting it in half. I'm going to take the greatest common factor out of each half. So first half, what would be the greatest common factor?
X.
X, we're left with?
2x plus 1.
Good, and then what would I take out of here?
3.
-3. We want to make sure that the signs here always match up, and we're left with 2x plus 1. Just take out a 3, the signs will be off. And remember, we want these two factors to be the same. So we have x minus 3 and 2x plus 1. Those are our factors. So we would then what?
Set them equal to
0. A lot of setting equal to 0. So here I get 3, and here I'm going to get negative 1 half. So I have 1, 2, 3 solutions. It was a cubic right here, cubic. So I get 3 answers. And you can check your answers, plug them back in, If you plug them back into the original, you'll just get like a true statement, something like 0 equals 0 or like 3 equals 3 or something. If you want to plug them in here, then you should get 0.
The number of answers that you get, is it always going to match up with the biggest exponent?
Yeah, but it might not be that many unique answers. So like you could get two of the same, but
okay.
Yes, it should always match up. Yeah.
Question: does this question for 2x cubed,
mm-hmm.
right? Doesn't that mean it should be 3 answers?
We do have 3. 1, 2, 3.
Oh, my bad. I didn't see 3.
You
Sorry.
Missed this one.
Yeah,
that one was like immediate. So don't forget that one. But yes, we do have 3.
Thanks.
Yeah. All right. Ready for you try? So the first thing we're gonna do for this guy is we're gonna divide everything by 3 because we can. Makes the numbers smaller. It's gonna give us cubes. Okay, is this a sum of cubes or a difference of cubes?
Sum.
Is a sum. Plus sign means sum of cubes. This is cubed, even if this is not cubed, even if this is not a perfect cube, you could still factor it that way. It just would be like ugly. So assume that they will be perfect cubes for the sake of the class.
Do you want to change it into a cube?
Hmm?
Are you supposed to change it into a cube?
You're kind of supposed to like look at it as a cube. So what cubed is 27?
3.
So this is like 3 cubed. What cubed is x cubed? Just x. So the way we're going to use the sum of cubes like formula, it's really formula, it's a factoring technique, but it's kind of like formula. This is like a, and this is like b. So everywhere you see a here, you can go ahead and stick an x in there. Everywhere you see b, I'm going to stick a 3, and then that's how we're going to factor it. So your first factor is x plus 3. Your second factor, x squared minus 3x plus 9, because 3 squared is 9, and it wants you to square b at the end there. The sum of cubes and the difference of cubes formulas are basically exactly the same. It's just the plus and the minus signs are in different places. So if you remember one, then you can just remember where the signs go for the second one. The sum of cubes starts with the plus, difference of cubes starts with the minus. Mm. And there's only one minus sign in each. Maybe you can figure out the rest from there. All right, so with these cubics, you're always gonna get one like simple linear factor, and that is gonna be your one real solution that you could have done, or you could have found without factoring it. You could have found that by just like kind of cube rooting both sides. But this one, this is gonna give you complex or imaginary solutions, which means it's not going to factor. So don't try to factor it. Okay, so if you like memorize this wrong and you get something that factors, it's wrong. Because this should not factor. You're only gonna get one real solution from a sum or even a difference of cubes. The other two will be imaginary. So it's our choice if we want to quadratic formula or complete the square.
Okay.
I'll go to quadratic formula. Because b is odd. So x equals negative b plus or minus square root of b squared minus 4, and then a is 1, times c is 9, all over 2a. Nine minus 36 is how many?
20.
Negative 27. And then over 2.
And then
does the negative square root of 27 simplify?
Yes.
3 and 9.
So.
But it's I.
3i root 3. Put it over here, I guess. So 3 plus or minus 3i root 3 over 2. Does that simplify?
Mm.
No. Now, it looks like one thing, but remember, it's technically two things. We have 3 plus 3i root 3 all over 2, and we have 3 minus 3i root 3 all over 2. That's two solutions that are imaginary, complex, and then you got your one real solution for a total of 3 because it's a cubic.
So do you have to write it out, or can you just put plus or minus?
No, again, just want you to realize that there are technically 3 there. And the complex solutions always come in pairs.
Okay.
So even though we sometimes write it as 1, it's 2. Questions? So it can be written quadratically because x cubed squared is x to the 6th. You see what I'm saying? So usually a quadratic equation is like x squared minus 2x plus 1, like something like this. And you can factor this, right? How do we factor this?
You do 2 times, or 1 times 1, right?
Mm-hmm.
Equal x minus 1.
X minus 1 and x minus 1? Okay, so we can factor this one the same way we factored this one, just slightly differently. Because we don't want these two to be x's, because then they would multiply to x squared. So we want them to multiply to x to the 6th. So basically, I'm just gonna write this here so you can kind of compare and contrast here. So instead of factoring it x minus 1, x minus 1, the ones are still the same. They multiply to negative 1 and they add to, I'm sorry, they multiply to positive 1 and they add to negative 2. The two, like, firsts, right, like first, outer, inner, last, in order for them to multiply to x to the 6th, those have to be cubed. And then the O and the I will add to negative 2x cubed. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah?
So you factor the same way,
you just
change,
you
just cube it.
Yeah, well, you change the this thing,
yeah,
like whatever's first,
yeah,
to whatever was here.
Okay.
And that's, if you look at like a regular quadratic, that's what you do as well. Like whatever's here, that's what goes first and first.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the same idea. Now you can't do this for all like sixth degree polynomials, but you can do it for this one because it's in a quadratic form. Okay, so there is gonna be one of these on your quiz, so you wanna make sure that you know how to do it. So after you factor it, then you're supposed to look at your factors. So if we look at our factors, they're both the same, right? So I'm gonna set them equal to 0. I'm just gonna set 1 equal to 0 because I don't need both of them, that's just a waste of time. How would we solve this?
That's a difference, right?
Exactly. It's a difference of cubes, right? All right, so it's a difference of cubes, so we need to factor it like a difference of cubes like we just did. So that's gonna be x minus 1 first, and then?
Oh, it's x squared plus
1
plus
1x, and then
plus 1.
Good. Good. Okay. Set these guys equal to 0, so x minus 1 equals 0, and then we're going to set this guy equal to 0. Our little linear binomial, that's going to equal 1, so that's our one real solution. And then here, what should we do?
It should square the thing squared.
Thing squared? What?
Factor.
Can't factor.
What are they about?
Well, that's quadratic formula. So B is odd. So we're gonna do x equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, which is just 4, divided by 2a. So we get negative 1 plus or minus the square root of negative 3 all over 2. We don't want to leave it like that. That looks dumb. Negative 1 plus or minus. We're going to take that I out. And then all over 2. We can't really simplify that. So those are our other two solutions. Now, how many solutions should we get?
Three.
Six.
Six. Where are the other three?
Are they the two solutions? Those things?
Mm-hmm.
Right, aren't they all like that? There's one.
Well, there's one, and then this is 2, 3. Where are the other three?
2, 0.
What do you mean?
It don't exist.
Okay, so we factored it.
Yeah.
And then we set it equal to 0.
So it's doubled.
It's doubled. So look, we had two of the same factors, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I only set one of them equal to 0, because I don't need to set the other one equal to 0, right? But there are three more, right? If I were to take this and set this equal to 0, I would have gotten another two of these and another one of those.
Well, that
so you have two of these, and you have two of these, and since this is technically 2, you got 4 here, and then you got your 2 here. That's 6. Know what I'm saying?
So how do
we... And what was the purpose of the right side of the equation?
Just to compare factoring techniques.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how do we write that on the quiz? Like, that looks better to be the
same?
You can
just do this and this. Like,
okay, so
you don't have
you
to
wouldn't ask
us. No. Yeah. All right, there's technically one more to try that I guess we don't have time for. But just maybe write it down. See if you can do it. You do have homework on